Good morning and welcome to the second of our new Music Scholars Masterclasses, the first of which was absolutely amazing. And I know we're in for a real treat today. So welcome, sit back and enjoy. And over to, and thank you to Mr. Colley for playing and being one of our Masterclass leaders. Thank you. So,
I'm going to play pieces Medoric's Originals number 2 by Charles Gounod.
Thank you. I think, especially in front of the cameras and all these people, you sing absolutely lovely. Great tone, really musical. Are you a singer as well as a horn player?
Yes.
Okay. So when you're playing, do you sing along at times?
I sing it in my head.
You sing it in your head?
I try to sing it in my head, which helps the note a bit more accurate.
Yeah, definitely. Do you know anything about this piece or this composer?
Not really.
It's quite an early piece for horn, isn't it? So Mr. Smith talked about the history of the piece. It's up to you to research that. It's really good to know about the style of the music you're playing. I thought we could work on the opening. It's horrible that you just stand there and just have to play a note all on your own, isn't it? How do we make it more secure? How do we get that first note absolutely confident? What's the key on the brass instrument?
Just like think what the note is and sing it in your head.
Sing in your head?
Yeah, just make sure you can hear it.
That's great.
What it sounds like.
And then how do you produce it really confidently?
Just start blowing the note.
Just start blowing the note? What about before the note? I know you do.
Oh, yeah,
a
big breath.
A big breath. Yeah. It's all about the big breath, isn't it? If I try and play that first note, I'm actually going. Sounds rubbish, doesn't it? That's a nice big crescendo and diminuendo on that first note, isn't it? Can we try that first note? I'm going to count you three beats in. What number will you breathe on if I count three beats in?
Two.
So you're going to take a two beat breath.
Yeah.
That's fine. Here we go then. One, two, three. Crescendo. Go on, more. We must always exaggerate dynamics. Okay, by the time we've thought of the dynamic, put it into the mouthpiece, put it through the instrument, and it's gone out there, it's been diluted. Okay? I didn't take a very good breath that time. Why don't try breathing over one beat? Breathe just before we play. Should we just practice the breath? So without the instrument, Lucas, watch me, it's going to be one, two, you do that for me. One, two, in, out. Now let's try that. Let's play the whole one. One, two, breathe. That's it. Bigger. What happens 4 bars later?
It's PP and it was the crescendos.
Yeah, it's like an echo, isn't it?
Yeah.
It actually says, doesn't it? They're long time. You know what that means?
Yeah.
In the distance.
Yeah.
Okay. It would probably be hand stopped on the horn, wouldn't it? But I think you're working on that
currently.
I'm not going to make you do that today. So the first note. 4 bars later. Any different, or was it still a big breath? Still a big breath. Now, after the first note, we need to set the atmosphere. What kind of atmosphere could this be? Where could you be if you were in a film?
Maybe in a desert or something.
Yeah, so very lonely. So set the scene in your head. Can you play the opening once more? Much bigger volume. Play as loud as you like, actually. Scare Mr. Colley behind you. Okay, knock his glasses off. Ready? One, two, three! More. Nice and strong. More. Keep it up. Loud. And deep breath and half the volume. Hear a difference in the dynamics? You've got to go for dynamics. Then the piano comes in, this next section. Andantino, meaning?
Back to speed.
Slightly quicker than a walking pace. So I wonder if we could go a little bit quicker. We go. We try that speed together with the piano from the Andantino. If I count you three beats in, what number are you going to breathe on? Yeah, breathe just before you're going to play. Ready? One, two, and. Move. you always play them on rec, or were you encouraged to play them on rec?
I know what it was.
That's fantastic. Dolce? What does Dolce
smooth
mean?
Smooth and quiet, peaceful.
Sweetly as well, sweetly. So the dynamic markings in music are quite often quite plain. It just says piano for the whole phrase. So you're a singer, how would you sing? Could you sing that phrase for me with the piano? One, two, and. Through the phrase. One, two, and. There's a deep breath. Take a deep breath in, Mr. Foster. One, two. Section once more from the Andantino. Could you crescendo through the first bar? A-dee-da-da. A big crescendo. Here we go. Deep breath. One, two. Crescendo. That's it. Push the air. So it's two different styles of dance, isn't it? What's a habanera?
It's like more smooth and slower, and then the ragtime is more quick and staccato.
Yeah, great. So the articulation.
Yeah.
Fantastic. What could we do at the beginning to make this beautiful lyrical tune more interesting to the listener?
Exaggerate the dynamics.
Exaggerate the dynamic. Yeah, definitely. It's hard when you're nervous, isn't it? You just picked up this huge piece of cold metal. All right, we've got to make it into a musical instrument.
Yeah.
Very good, sorry. Once more, why don't you take a breath as well? If I count you four beats in, what are you going to be about?
Four
beats, so it'd be one, two, three, play. Ready? One, two, three. Crescendo. Section. I'm going to stand over here and listen for these dynamics. Take a deep breath. I'm not going to count you in this time.
Thank you.
We always want to be interesting, especially on a tuba. Right, it sounds like... That's why I said that, didn't I? What can we do with those last two notes? Something to do with the articulation.
Trill?
No, something to do with the articulation. It's actually written.
Attack it?
Yeah. That's it. So just, can we just finish off the bar before that?
Yeah.
One, two, three, four. That's it. Ready? Take a breath. One, two, three, four.
Now we've got some piano performances. Very pleased to have Samuel Lau here, who's going to play Bach, actually, instead of the Copland. It's the Bach Prelude in A minor from Book 2. Are you doing both the Prelude and the Fugue? Yes, and the Fugue. Thank you. fantastic performance of an extremely complicated and very difficult piece, which you're playing very well, and with a lot of character too. I find it amazing when you think how long ago these pieces were written, the complexity of them, for the audience point of view. Do you mind if we just have a little look at the prelude for a while? This is a remarkable piece because if you notice, each hand is only playing one note at a time. That's all the way through. It's what's called a two-part texture. There's no complicated chords, just a single line in the left hand and a single line in the right hand. But what an incredible density of sound is created. One thing you've got to remember, and I think I'll say this to anyone who plays Bach, including myself. I remember when I was taught about Bach, somebody said to me, whatever you do with Bach, somebody's going to object to it, because for two reasons. First of all, there were no pianos in Bach's time, but I'm sure that if Bach had had a wonderful influence instrument like this Steinway Model D, he would have enjoyed playing it as you are. And in fact, Bach sounds fantastic on the piano. I think these Prelude and Fugues, taken from a huge volume of two books, 48 Preludes and Fugues in all the different keys, and some of them seem as though they would have been written, of course there were no pianos at that time, some of them would have been written for the harpsichord maybe, some of them more for the clavichord, which is Bach's favourite instrument, because that had very quiet sound but a bit of touch sensitivity in it. In other words, if you play louder, if you push it hard, you get a louder sound. Some of them work for the organ maybe because of the long sustain. But I think as a compromise instrument, you can't get too badly with a piano. So I'm just thinking about this. Can you just play a little bit over so you can hear what's going on there in terms of the line and the chromaticism of it? It's quite remarkable. So let's listen to the opening again. Each hand has got absolutely the same role to play and the same level of involvement. So when you're playing it, you've got to be aware of that, which you are, you're playing very musically. Sometimes the left hand's got the main interest there, and sometimes the right. I just wonder with the texture, whether it might be better, but what do you think the mood of it is, and what mood do you feel as a performer, this or the prelude?
Slightly higher.
So, no, I just wonder what you think, what it says to you, this music. That's a difficult question. It's really hard, you have to play it to find out, don't you? Do you enjoy playing this?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Out of these two, the Prelude and the Fugue, which one do you prefer?
The Prelude.
The Prelude, yeah. And why do you think that is? Apart from the fact that it's really difficult. Can I just say something about your Fugue? I think that's trivial. That Fugue, it starts out, doesn't it? Just play the opening of the subject. I just remember when I was learning this, you start, oh, that sounds good. You go, duh, 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 duh. And then you'll be flat on your face and people are like, this is the most remarkable piece, isn't it? Those are crotchets at the beginning. And then he subdivides the beat into it. Then he wants to end up demi-semi, clever quaver. And then suddenly you're going off the planet with speed. You judged that absolutely fantastic. I think your tempo for this Fugue is absolutely spot on. But I mean, I wonder whether with the prelude, you might just try and slightly slow it, just so you can hear. There's an awful lot going on in terms of suspensions as well. Suspension where you've got the top line hold a note on, which clashes with the bass, and then the bass resolves it. I mean, you're singing or playing on an organ, you can hear these things clearly. I think maybe on the piano, on a nice big sounding instrument, you can hear the suspension. Let's just start there, and maybe just try a note slower. Not completely different, but just a little bit
slower.
being inserted part, so that's very nice. Well, thank you, Samuel, very much. So we're looking really at a romantic style of music where the melodies are extremely important. The melody's a long melody at the beginning, isn't it? The interesting thing with this piece is that people hear it, dum dum, but actually the piece starts with a rest, doesn't it? There's a rest. It's a bit like John Cage, isn't it? Before the piece starts, and the first thing you do is you don't play. You play have a play with the rest. So that's really important in terms of the rhythm of this piece, which is very complicated. In the same time series, isn't it? It's 9-8, and it starts with a 1 and a 2. So it's in a slow 3. Do you just want to play a little bit of the open there? What you're looking for here is a really sort of pearlescent, glowing sound. It's a beautiful key as well. This key. Can you play me that low D flat? You can put your pedal down. Give us a bit more of that. This note. It's the resonant sweet spot of the piano, the D flat. It's interesting because it's just where it's situated within the construction of the piano. Those D flats sets everything off, and that's why, or possibly why, this key is used so much by composers, Chopin, loads of things in D flat, Debussy, Liszt, you think about in Sospiro, the beautiful sound, yeah, it gives a bit of Sospiro as well. Rachmaninoff, second piano concerto, the third piano concerto, the big movement, the Paganini variations. It's the most amazing thing. So Debussy was very aware of the sound, but it's great to hear. So let's just do that. And even when you're playing quietly with a big piano, you need to get your hand right into the key bed. You have a feeling of connecting with it, like that, even on a quiet note. So let's have that again and project. And also when you're playing in a big room like this, even though it's marked P, there's no such thing as playing P like that. You've got to play P up to those little cherubs on the top of there. Right. Impressionism, isn't it? It was creating a, painting a picture. Moonlight. Well, moonlight, I mean, it could mean anything, but to me it would mean something pretty still and peaceful, nocturnal, but very, very still. It's an evening, isn't it? Hints of romance, like the nice perfumes in the air, that sort of thing. So a whole long phrase, it's very difficult on an instrument, but every time you hit a note, you bang like that, to try and create a line. And if you're singing, and we'll be hearing people singing later, you can just keep your line going, or with a brass instrument, you can keep the line. With a piano, you have to create a sense of line by balancing one note against the other. You're doing a very, very nice job there. So let's just have that nice phrase once more.
From the start.
Yeah, let's do that and get that nice ping in the sound. Interestingly, because you've got big notes at the beginning and bass note, which you want to hold on. Now, normally the piano you want to hold a note on and you can't hold it, you have to use the pedal, which is the right pedal. The trouble with that is, if you hold that one and you just keep the pedal down, the rest of it's just put your pedal down for the whole thing, and you just to demonstrate, you just switch your bass, don't change it at all. So you do that one with your left foot, and then you do that one. Can we just demonstrate that again, just to show?
So
get
just
that. I think a big bass note, you have to play it first, and then collect it. That's now there. It's free to move the other pedal, and at the end of it, that bass note's still there. Lift. It's nice, isn't it? But people, this is what you should do. The trouble with that is you practice doing it, and then you get to some gig, and there's a horrible old pub piano. It's a damper pedal. But we're lucky we don't have that at rugby school, we've got these things. So all of you, I recommend, explore the sostenuto pedal. I think we're going to have to stop now, but can we give a big applause to her? really good Beethoven playing, and it should be because we're in his 250th year, as I keep saying, even if we've just got another lockdown, it's not Ludwig's fault. But this is Beethoven's 250th anniversary, and it's lovely to hear him being played with such freshness and spirit by a young pianist, and really, you've captured that really, really well. Most importantly, and all the spirit of it is, I think, very true to what was intended here. It's a bit of a strange piece, this one. It was, what did you say, called Allatinesca?
Yeah.
Do you know what that means? Which language is it?
Is it in Italian?
It's Italian, but it actually means in the German style, in Italian. I don't know why he did that, but it was German anyway. So it's in the German style, I mean, in more German style. What sort of music does this remind you of? I was just thinking a bit sort of rough and ready folk music, isn't it? German, some of those lederhosen sort of beer hall dances, I think, don't you? Especially, you know the bit with the left hand, but it's got the tune on the left hand. So I think he's enjoying that reference, and it's a sense of humour here, I think, the piece. I mean, sometimes Beethoven's incredibly serious. Here, I think he had a fantastic sense of humour, and he's just, it's very much to the fore. And that's what, you've really captured that in your playing, that's what's lovely about it. And it's presto. What does presto mean? It means fast, doesn't it? And it is fast. You don't want this to be a... You really need to keep going with it. And you are. I think your speed's fine. It doesn't need to be any faster than that. I think that's a good tempo for a performance of this. I think one of the most important things with Beethoven in terms of is the rhythm. A very strong rhythm. And here, and the pulse especially, is to try and keep the pulse constant so you don't get halfway through and realise, whoops, we've gone into the slow lane. You need to keep it going. And you did that extremely well. And also, the other thing with Beethoven, which Ben's captured really well, are the dynamic contrast. There's some quite fierce dynamic contrast in here. And I think you could exaggerate it even slightly more, if you like. Also, it's the ending, it's amazing, it's got a complete chocolate ending. Like that. So, at the very end, I think just stand up. I know you're just sitting around in a masterclass, but in this difficult playing, it's somebody looking behind you like that. But very, very lovely performance. Could just do a bit of a throwaway ending at the end. Shall we just start it again and think of that? Those lederhosen people. Let's see if we can imagine them all dancing around on a hill somewhere in some little village in Bavaria or something, I think it probably is. So let's think of that and start again.
Thank you.
takes time around the corners as well, because he's still has a lot of subtlety and the lovely natural musical things. Let's just have this last bit really sort of in present style. Can you go from where we just got to? Bum, bum. With the left hand. Do you want to stop? You know the bit, I mean, just think the back of you as rough as you like. Really enjoy it. But that's where his humour really comes from, where the left hand's got the tune. You know what I mean? Bum, 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 bum. Really rough. It's real beer hall stuff. Going to play Andante in A by Haydn, who incidentally was Beethoven's piano teacher and composition teacher, I think, so interesting connection. Towards the end, it's happened in a lot of classical music. You start off with a few notes, and then it gets really fiddly towards the end. It's variation, doesn't it? Do you think it might be better just to start it just a little bit slower? Because then that'll give you a bit more time for these nice decorated things, very highly ornate decorated things, which Haydn also enjoyed doing, just to speak a little bit. With this, again, it's got a nice tune, it's simple, a bit fancy tune, isn't it? Again, a sort of folk sense. So I think plenty of melody line, and then just keep the thing going. Do you want to just try a bit again? Maybe just a tiny bit slower. Just to give you some more time to speak. sort of the dark plot, those Scandinavian detective series, that type of thing, filmed in a particular style, low light. So what you're doing here is creating the atmosphere of that sort of film, which is atmospheric. And style is it's quite jazzy, really, isn't it? I think when I was in it, I thought I could imagine the bass and drums going on. It would be nice if we had that, Mr. David, if we could have some brushes, because that's what it needs, brushes and an upright bass with it, really. So you haven't got this, you've just got to imagine they're there and have them going in your head. A lot of the time, the left hand is doing crotches, especially on that second page, isn't it? So they're like, that's like your bass guitar. It's like your, I'm not your bass guitar, your upright string bass, because it's film noir, we wouldn't have an electric guitar, would we? But, so that, imagine that, if you imagine that, then it'll help them to project that. Some lovely chords, you know, it's very, very well. The rhythm's good, it just needs to keep going all the time at the same speed, so that the audience know, imagine there's four in every bar. Sometimes, and it's not your fault, Mike Cullen just stops it, and you've got to imagine they count it. So even when it stops a while, just keep in your mind, imagine it, you know, Pink Panther sort of accompaniment. Just start that again, and imagine you're actually playing this in a film, which is creating an atmosphere, and so you're creating it. I thought you came out with, firstly, that chord at the end is fantastic. Just play this that last chord. See, that's it, isn't it? That's the sinister detective, or somebody seeing some sort of clue in the chord. I think that's what you're looking for. So, all of that, as much of that as you can find in this music.
Thank you.
to work very hard on it, to get around the notes extremely well. It's just an interesting piece, isn't it, in terms of the music that influenced it. I mean, this is clearly influenced by the ragtime music of the very early part of the 20th century and the end of the 19th century, that you think of Scott Joplin, that type of thing, a ragtime, a cakewalk. Cakewalk's a walk which is effortless, it's to show off that you're not worried about anything. So it's got to sound really relaxed and, you know, like not caring in the world, walking along in your nice suit, looking around, having a good day. So it's very happy, isn't it? And then we get the middle section, which is it's quite interesting. Just as a sideline, in the middle section of this, Debussy actually makes a reference to Wagner, to Tristan and Isolde, because there's a lot of Wagner, massive composer of the 19th century, who evolved harmony to a new level. And there was always a bit of a schism, but Debussy was actually heavily influenced by Wagner. But I think he's just sort of, I think what you call cocking the snooker, Wagner here. Just play that a little bit, because he does da do. And then it's always, yeah, and it always has a bit of laughter afterwards. It's very nice. You know what I mean? Yeah, just around there. Because this tune here, in the right hand, that's part of the Tristan overture.
Maybe a little bit more pedal, maybe, and I like those little pinky pompers at the top, very
Well, thank you very much. What a wonderful session we've just had. Thank you to Mr. Colley and Mr. Foster for such insightful comments. It's absolutely amazing. And thank you for your encouragement to these wonderful musicians. Let's give those two a big round of applause. And thank you very much to our audience. For those of you who are watching on the live stream, thank you very much for joining us. We have got quite a small audience here. You can't see them, but they are all very socially distanced. So thank you for coming and being socially distanced, and thank you for joining us on the live stream. But the biggest thank you, of course, is to our fantastic performers who have done so well this morning. Lucas, Samuel, Arthur, Ben, Tyrion, Josephine and Isabel, thank you so much for all you've done this morning. Let's give them a big round of applause. Thank you. And that's not all, because we've got our final session this afternoon. Really looking forward to that. So please join us again at 2:30. Thank you very much.